Welcome to my first show, the classic car Mustang show, whatever we want to call it show. See, that's the good thing about having your own show. And if you produce it and you have your own cameras and have everything, you can do whatever you want. And that's what I'm doing. And I'm having a lot of fun doing it because all my followers out there have told me what they're looking for out of a show. And I'm trying to do that with what I got to work with. Hopefully in the future, I'll have enough funding to make the quality of my videos, to make the quality of my sound. Be patient, I'm doing what I can. And the quality of the photography to a level where it'll be equal to something you'd see on some of the big cable shows. But for the time being, this is what I got, and I hope I'm making it pretty good for you. But this show is really going to be surrounded about the Toys for Tots Foundation. And there'll be a segment in my show that'll concentrate on what my effort towards Toys for Tots is all about. And I want to try and do it as big a way as I can. I'm going to do a little how-to video thing. I'm going to show you some progress of my cars. I've got a little segment in there as far as the value of Mustangs and classic cars and what they really mean nowadays. I'm probably going to push a couple of items, like some of the items that get sent to me as far as promos. And my own spots I have, my own things I have. So you'll have to deal with me on a little bit of promo here and there. But the main substance of my show is to try and educate people out there and try and show them what they can maybe do on their own in their garage. It comes down to dollars and cents, and the more dollars and cents you and I can have in our pockets, the better. And if I can help that and give back because you guys have done for you what you can do for me and made me a success, that's what this is all about. That's what this show is all about. So watch the rest of my show. I know I'm having a lot of fun doing it, and I hope you have a lot of fun watching it. So we'll see you back at the next segment. Not looking too good for that one there. But there's a reason why people come to the Doctor of Restoration with their Mustangs and classic cars, is because they're pretty much almost dead. And you know what, this is just a prop, but it's not too far from being the truth on old cars. If they had a pulse, I'd be up to check them out, and some of these things, they just don't have a pulse. Here at Mustang Restorations, if you guys don't know me as the Doctor of Restoration with my how-to videos, I get a lot of cars in there like this. This 69 Mach 1 has been sitting on the side of a house for probably 10 years. The undercarriage is rotted away. It's going to need floor pans. It's going to need torque boxes. It's going to need inner rocker frame rails where the front floors are supported. The rear frames and trunk floors are shot on it. The good thing, though, the market on old cars and Mustangs is at a level where even a car like this is worth putting together. So it's not like this is a wasted investment for somebody to buy and then have done. Certainly you don't want to pay dumb money for something like this, but if you got it cheap enough, it still makes sense dollar-wise to put it together. And then you got yourself a classic car and something that has value. With the way the stock market has been, up and down, up and down. We won't even talk about real estate and housing. And then the economy, just the way things are going, classic cars, and especially it seems to be these Mustangs, have really been holding their value. Classic car owners are pretty smart people, man. I mean, they're not dumb, and they haven't gotten themselves into a lot of those messes that a lot of people have gotten themselves into out there, and a lot of it is not even their fault for doing it. It's the government's fault. But back to these Mustangs and the classic cars, these cars are solid investments. These are blue chip items right here. And they're not difficult to sell. It comes down to anything else. If you have something that's nice and you got a nice Mustang or a nice old classic car, it's going to sell, and it's going to sell relatively quickly because there's still guys out there that are looking to buy these things. You know, when the whole collapse of this whole economy came about, everybody just stopped buying things and everything froze for a while, including classic cars. But the big guys, the guys that were buying a $250,000 and a $500,000 and $1 million cars, they never stopped buying. Sure, they lowered their sights a little bit. They weren't looking to buy the $500,000, $250,000 cars, but they came down to the level of these kind of classic cars, these Mustangs and Camaros and whatnot, that are in maybe the $20,000, $15,000, $30,000, $40,000 range. That's chump change for a lot of people, you know. Maybe not myself, but there are some people out there that they'll just open their wallet up right out of check and they can buy one of these things. So there's a big market for these old Mustangs and these old classic cars that are in this range here. So keep that in mind. These cars here that we got around here at Mustang Restorations are cars that are going to be put back together. Check this bad boy out. Here's a nice little survivor. It's a 70 Mach 1 351 Cleveland 4-speed car. Sitting up in Wisconsin. Guy had it on the side of his house for years and years. The paint, it's almost like a chalkboard. It's so chalked out, it has no shine in it at all. Same thing. We're doing floor pans, we're doing torque boxes, we're doing some framework to it, we're doing quarter panels. Guy bought it for a song, so it's worth putting back together and he's going to have some pride and joy. It also makes it easy for him to do because he can just put a small amount of money down at a time and eventually get the thing done. This one over here, check out this yellow one. Yellow 70 Mach 1. Here's a good example of one that started out as like the green car or the red car. And we've put the full quarters on it. We got a set of doors on it. It needed a little bit of floor work done to it. The taillight panel and the trunk were shot on it. Same thing. He got into it real low, and his dollars spent on the car is more for the restoration than the actual price of the car. So it made sense for him. And in the end, he'll be right at the range or probably below the range of what the thing is worth. But he's not putting it together anyways to sell. He's going to hold on to it, keep it, have fun with his family and kids. And then he'll have something that's worth something years down the road that he can either hand down to his kids and family, or just sell, and then he's got something in his pocket. So these are blue chip investment automobiles, these Mustangs and these classic cars. So keep an eye on that. Keep an eye on your paper to start picking these things up because they are out there. And we'll move on to the next segment of my show in a couple minutes. See you then. And I have a lot of fun doing this, and I have like funny props I use because I am the doctor of restoration. But you know, all kidding aside, there's another effort I'd like to concentrate on, and it's called the Toys for Tots Foundation. Everybody knows Toys for Tots, but you know, I want to give back in a way where it'll feel good for me, and in appreciation for the efforts that everybody's been putting behind me. If I can get 5,000 followers on my Twitter between now and, say, Thanksgiving, I'm going to give out 100 of these little kind of cars like this to boys for Toys or Tots, and 100 little dolls for girls for Toys or Tots. Not only that, I've got two of the Power Wheel motorized Mustangs, one for a girl and one for a boy, that's going to be given out also. So it's a really big effort to do. And I tell you what, even if I only get one follower through my Twitter, I'm still giving them away. But it's a way for everybody to do the same thing for me too. So please, follow me, get me up to 5,000 so we can give these things out. Again, I'm giving them out either way, but hey, let's make it look good on paper here and do the right thing for Toys or Tots. I remember as a boy always having a car in my hand. I mean, I was lucky enough where my dad and my mom were able to give me toys and whatnot. There's a lot of kids out there that just don't have that same thing, and I want that to happen for them too. So that's what this effort is all about. So go to my website, classicmustangtelevision.com. If you scroll down a little bit, you'll be able to click on the Toys for Tots logo for more information behind this effort. So please, go to my website, check me out. I'm the doctor of restoration, and remember, this doctor is always in. Update on the right-hand drive Mustang we're putting together. Obviously what we're trying to do here is make the steering go on the right side of the car as opposed to on the left side like we have here in the States. And I think our effort's going pretty good. They do make somewhat of a kit to put together for this. It's not really a kit as per se. You got to buy all these pieces. Most of the companies out there don't stock them because who's putting right-hand drive cars together? And the sum of all that together adds up to be just an astronomical amount just for the parts alone. It didn't make sense for us to go that route when we can just make things in-house. So that's where we're at now, is custom making this dash. We're fitting up the dash pad. We have the left, which was the right hand, is now the left hand panels fitted into place. Glove boxes over here, radio opening. We've put our heater controls down over here, so it'll be right next to the driver or left next to the driver. And then we have our gauge pod put into place. So we're getting there. It's taken us a little bit of time, but the effort certainly has been worth it. It's going to be a stick shift car, which is kind of neat. And I can't wait to take this thing out down the road, man. I mean, I've driven a couple of Rolls-Royce cars that I've worked on in the past that were right-hand drive cars, and that was pretty neat. But you kind of expected it from a Rolls. To drive a right-hand drive Mustang is going to be so neat for me. I tell you what, I can't wait till this project is done. Oh, hey, good morning. I'm just doing my morning rounds here at Mustang Restorations, checking the pulse of all these Mustangs. And this one seems to be surviving pretty good. If you guys remember and you've been watching my Mustang restoration video series, you'll see that this is the car that the tree fell on. Apparently the guy had a tree fall through his house, through his garage, and ultimately land on this Mustang. And it crushed the windshield frame, crushed the cowl, crushed the hood, and eventually landed on the steering wheel and dashboard area. Well, the last two installments showed us bringing this thing back into shape. Since then, we've put a windshield in it, we've put the trim back on it, we've welded and edged out the cowl, we've installed the hood, and we started the alignment process. And the alignment process basically comes from us here, is making these panels align better than Ford did back in the day. You know, they were pumping these things out so fast, they had 2 million of these Mustangs made before the 1966 year series. As a matter of fact, they had a 2 millionth Mustang that they celebrated. So they certainly weren't looking at their lines as much as we do today. And our effort here at Mustang Restorations is to get the lines equal to a new car today, where you can almost roll a ball bearing down these lines. And that's what we're doing. Make all these panels that are adjacent to one another nicely corresponded, where they're flat. And it's almost like one big piece of steel that we've cut the panels out and made our own. That's the effort behind this here. So anyways, I'm checking the pulse on this one. This one's coming along real good. And keep an eye on my next video on this tree falling on Mustang series. And by then it should be painted and it should be a car that's together. You know what? This car is actually going to end up being better than it was the day it rolled off the factory because of the lines we're doing, because of the efforts we're making behind here to make it a better car. So keep an eye on my videos. I'm the doctor of restoration, and keep in mind that this doctor is always in. Check out my website, classicmustangtelevision.com. I have a lot of cool videos going up there. I'm looking to open up my weekly online show, and we're going to go from there. So remember, I'm the doctor of restoration, and this doctor, I'm always in. Thanks for watching. It's been a little while since I've given you guys a little shop tour, so I thought I'd take some time today and walk around the shop and, hey, show you a couple things we got going. Real quick, we got this Mustang 66 convertible here that we've taken the doors off of because the lower fronts of them have the usual rust on it. So we're going to cut out that rust and we're going to replace it with steel, and then we're going to put the doors back on, fit them, and then do our paintwork. That's going to be a relatively quick job over here. This one here, this is a 70 Chevelle. Well, what the heck is a 70 Chevelle doing in a Mustang shop? One thing I learned years ago is when I do cars for my Mustang customers, they would trade them up or down, and they go on from a Mustang to maybe a Chevrolet or to a Buick or to a Pontiac, and then they come back to me and say, hey Chris, you know what? I really like the work you did on my Mustang. Is there any way you can do something for me on my my other muscle car? Well, if I can accommodate people, I certainly will. If I can't do it, I'll tell them straight out. But I grew up working on all sorts of American muscle, and so these things are right up my alley. So although it says Mustang Restorations, I do other cars too, and I don't limit myself to just Mustangs. But anyways, 70 Chevelle, small block car, bucket seat console, in for being stripped and repainted. That's going to be a cool project to work on. Once in a while, it's kind of neat to do other things on Mustangs. Over here, I got this 66 convertible that from the outside, the car looks beautiful. Somebody really did their homework on the paintwork on it. But then you open up the hood and the motor compartment doesn't look that good at all. And what I found with Mustangs is, and classic cars, they are magnets. So people just go right to them. And most guys say, hey man, your car looks cool, pop the hood, let me check it out. Well, you know, you end up popping your hood and you're like, well, I haven't quite done my engine yet. So this guy's in to have us do his motor compartment. So this way underneath his hood looks just as good as the outside of the car. And another cool thing to do. What's behind me on the rack is a Pontiac Firebird. Guy had a 67 Mustang convertible that he enjoyed for years, but he always wanted a big block Pontiac convertible. And that thing there is a 400 five-speed car. It's got a five-speed stick in it. So same thing, old-time customer, newer type of muscle car, I'll accommodate them. And that's another cool project. We got this Shelby lookalike car here that I just got in the other day. It's a 65 Fastback that in its day somebody had tried to make it into a Shelby looking thing, and they hacked it up and cut it up back then when these things weren't worth much. Well, now it's in for us to put it back together the way it should be. Quarter panels, fenders, doors, fix the openings where somebody put windows in on the roof. Another good project. A couple other things we got going here on this video. Got a 70 coupe. That same thing, somebody had hacked in some quarter panels in its day, and then they just bubbled back and didn't work out. So we're putting a new set of quarter panels and a new set of wheel wells on it. And actually gonna replace the taillight panel too. They bonded in and brazed all sorts of stuff on this thing. And then lastly on this video, I got this 64 Malibu convertible. Same thing, guy had a Mustang. He wanted us to do some work for him on his newer car. This was his grandfather's car. He's kept it all this time, but a rough car just the same. The floors were rotted out on it. Some of the frames were rotted out on it. So we're putting in a complete floor pan in the thing, complete framing underneath it. And it's a different animal than a Mustang. GM's kind of had a different thought process when they put their cars together. But anyways, we're gonna enjoy doing that. doing now is with this whole Mustang thing and classic car thing that has just been a phenomenon for me, is a lot of emails. I mean, I get emails and phone calls from people all around the world. It's become a global thing for me, from something that used to be, you know, the next town over, or maybe even the next state over. This whole internet thing has enabled me to talk to people in Australia, talk to people in Finland. I mean, I get calls from people all over the world. And it's pretty neat to do, man. It's a lot of fun. But that being said, let me read you a few of these emails. I got a kid in Canada that's got a 70 convertible that he's always dreamed of having, finally got the car, and he tells me here that from an outwardly appearance, the car actually looks pretty good. The top is decent, the paint is okay, the interior is pretty good, but the undercarriage rust, floors, and frames are in pretty bad shape. And he can't seem to find anybody up there that really not only knows what they're doing, but can do it in a manner where it's affordable for him. Because if you don't know what you're doing on something and you have to experiment with it, you tend to want to charge more, so this way you can charge people for the mistakes you might make. And that's understandable. Where if you bring whatever it is you got to, like a Mustang, to a shop like mine, we're going to get right on it, we're going to do what we're going to do, so odds are we're probably going to be less money than a shop that does other cars or a plumber. My suggestion to him was that maybe take some classes in school. You know, schooling is a great thing. We all need more education in this world. So why don't you get together with your high school advisor and get into a type of shop class where you can get into welding, because welding is going to be a big thing on the bottom of this Mustang. And I'm not suggesting that he does the inner rockers and the torque boxes and things like that. What I did suggest was, if he could make an effort to get this car down for me, which might be a little bit of an expensive endeavor for him, but if he can do that, I, from Mustang Restorations and my crew, at no charge to him, will do the inner rockers, we'll do the torque boxes, we'll get the foundation of this car so it's steady and firm, so he can take it back up there. With the knowledge that he's learned from this welding class, he could probably throw in a set of floors, and he could probably throw in a set of lower firewalls, and some of the smaller, what I would consider some of the smaller welding things. Sure, I would coach him over the phone and lead him down a few paths when he run into things, but the main stuff, the foundation stuff that actually holds the convertible up, is what we would do here for him anyways, so he really couldn't get himself in trouble. And what he's done for himself, he's got himself the car he kind of wants, he's got the inner rockers and floors done to hold the thing up, he's put in floors maybe by himself, he's got an education on how to weld, and who knows, if he's that good at it, maybe he can go from that to either work for a shop for welding or open up his own place to weld. So I try and give out as much advice as I can in that, and that's just one of the emails that I get. I got another guy here that, you know, I wish I could actually afford to fly out to some of these people around the country. This guy here tells me that the economy has hit him pretty hard, and his dad had left him a 70 Mustang Fastback in his garage. His dad passed away and this thing was left in the garage to him. Well, because of the economy the way it is, he can't necessarily afford to do some of the things on it. And from what it says here, the car hasn't run in like 5 or 6 years. You know, if I had all the money in the world, I would get on a plane, fly out there, bring a few tools with me, and then work with the guy in his garage and try and get this his dad's car up and running for him. So what I'm going to try and do, I'm going to try and give him a few tips through the email. Probably pick up the phone, call him, see if I can coach him over the phone and get him as far as I can. But those are the kind of the heart-wrenching ones I get once in a while. You know, it really, really affects me in that way. And then I got a woman out in California that emailed me, and she's got a later Mustang. She's got a 90s Mustang that she's having a lot of convertible top problems with. You know, a lot of these Mustangs they made in the 80s and the 90s were afterthought convertible engineered, meaning that when they made the early Mustangs, being a convertible was on the table right from the start. I mean, there was no afterthought of that at all. But then as the convertibles started phasing out in the 70s and even in the early 80s, they had no plans of making convertibles. There was big insurance regulations on those cars, and convertibles were considered unsafe for a while there, believe it or not. So when Ford reintroduced the Mustang convertible, it was more their hardtop that they chopped the roof off of and pop riveted a bunch of like reinforcements underneath it, and hence they got a convertible. And in some respects, they're a little awkward in ways. And the problems that she's running into is these afterthought type of things. The arrangement of the rear windows, the way they come up, the arrangement of the top, the way it goes down. And so I'm gonna give her a call and try and lead her through a few tips that I can give her. Again, if it was something I could fly out there, I certainly would hop on a plane and fly out there and do what I could for her. But you know, I still will at least email her back and forth, pick up the phone and call her, maybe even talk to her mechanic and see if I can lead him down a path that'll fix this thing for her. So I get a lot of emails. Email me as much as you want. I'll try and answer them all and try and lead you to a good fix on the car. Because I am the doctor of restoration, and I am literally always in. Ask my wife, she'll tell you. I'm always down here, and I always hear from her. You're always down there at the shop. Well, I am the doctor of restoration, so I have to be in. So keep an eye on the rest of my show, and I'll be back for the next segment in a couple minutes. Okay, I'm back with my Mustang restoration t-shirt. Just got this thing out here, man. Check it out. It's got my dad's yellow Mustang on it. He bought that thing brand new in 1968, ordered it in 67. And I remember as a kid riding in that thing for the first time from the Ford dealer, man, I was proud as heck. Everybody wanted Mustangs, and finally my dad's got one. The other car there is a Mustang limousine that I made. This thing I made about 20 years ago. And that is such a great likeness of this thing. These shirts are pretty cheap. I have them here for sale, but I also give them away on a lot of things, a lot of charity things. I got a Toys for Tots thing going. Look at my website, classicmustangtelevision.com. Go to the logo on that, and you can kind of contribute to a Toys for Tots thing. I got a campaign going there, and it'll spell it out on there. So till next time on my show, I plan to have maybe some guests on. I plan to have a how-to time. My plans are to have some products that we're going to do a review on. The doc is going to put products to the test. If they don't pass my test, I know they're not going to pass your test. Because I always look at every product I do as something, as you know, could the guy in his garage at home put this thing on with little or no tools, without filing something, without wrenching on something, without tweaking it to make it work. To me, it should come out of the package, do very little fitting to it, and just go on the car. And if those products don't do that, hey, they're not going to get a review from the doc. So watch my show next week, and until then, remember, this doctor, the doctor of restoration, I'm always in. Thanks for watching my show. Can't be me, I'm a rock star. I'm running on the top of a cross car. I'm a rebel, I'm a 4-4.